It is now time for question period. Her Majesty, the Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
And now for something completely different, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Acting Premier. Acting Premier, cap and trade is a carbon tax by any other name. There's no way around it. This scheme isn't about reducing greenhouse gas emissions. It's about taking more money from the taxpayers to fund this government's spending addiction. It's pretty simple. When businesses pay more, consumers pay more. By imposing this tax on businesses, you will drive up the cost of everything in this province. It's a tax on everything. Acting Premier, how much money will this scheme cost Ontario families?
Speaker, I have to say I'm disappointed at this approach. Climate change is already happening, Speaker, and we are already paying the price for climate change. Speaker, the record rain in Toronto in 2013 cost almost $1 billion. The ice storm in 2013 cost $200 million in insurance costs, Speaker, and experts are predicting that this cost of climate change will grow dramatically over the next number of years, Speaker, if we don't take action. So, what is very strange to me, Speaker, is just a few weeks ago, all parties in this House voted in favour of a motion to take action on climate change, Speaker.
Answer.
We are taking that action, and I expect you to stand with us.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Back to the Acting Premier, Mr. Speaker. You recently cancelled the clean energy benefit. Many families, farms, and small businesses will have a
10%
increase in their electricity rates. This province already has ridiculously high electricity prices, and ratepayers, we've been told, will see a further $140 rise in their rates this year, as well as losing the 10%. Now you want to raise at least $1 billion with your tax on everything. Australia's carbon tax scheme costs the average family $550 per year. Before common sense prevailed and the program was cancelled. Acting Premier, with many people in Ontario already struggling to pay their bills, where will they find the money to pay this new carbon tax?
Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, as I said before, people are already paying the costs of climate change. We are paying it in our insurance rates. We are paying it in the health of our children, our grandchildren, our parents, our grandparents, Speaker. We must take action. And if the party opposite is saying we just have to let this problem, we have to leave it to the next generation, we fundamentally disagree with you. That is a point of clear distinction between them and us. We believe we have a responsibility to take action now. We've set our path. We will be going with a cap-and-trade approach, Speaker, in concert with the province of Quebec, with the province of British Columbia. That's 75% of Canadians will be operating under a cap-and-trade approach to reduce carbon emissions.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
The Premier, your carbon tax will raise the price of everything that Ontarians buy on a store shelf. It will raise the price of every service they use that requires any form of transportation to deliver that service. And Acting Premier, after the gas plant scandal, the green energy windmill scandals and disaster, the $2 billion on smart meters, Orange, e-health, everything you do in the energy sector, you make into a boondoggle. Why should Ontarians trust that this won't be another multi-billion dollar boondoggle?
Well, Speaker, there are many people in the Conservative Party who are encouraging us to take this action, including Preston Manning, Speaker. Preston Manning, not known to be a Liberal, is saying, take action, Speaker. We have taken action. We have taken the largest climate change initiative in North America by shutting down our dirty coal plant, Speaker. That's $4.4 billion in avoided costs. It's like taking 7 million cars off the road. We are committed to doing our part for a cleaner environment, a more sustainable environment. We're taking action. I'd love to hear your positive suggestions on what we need to do.
Thank you. New question. Member from Huron-Bruce.
Thank you very much, Speaker. My question is to the Acting Premier. Acting Premier, your carbon tax will make it more expensive to buy anything made in Ontario, more expensive to drive your car, to buy your groceries, and more expensive to heat your home. The most vulnerable of Ontarians will be hurt by this tax.
Minister of Aboriginal Affairs.
For those already struggling to make ends meet, it's about to get even harder. Your consultations proved just that. I was there, and I heard from the people of Ontario. But unfortunately, I'm sad
Minister of Transportation.
To say, your government has chosen to ignore them. You don't care that they cannot afford this tax. Acting Premier, will you rethink this disastrous tax on everything and admit your climate change consultations were nothing but a sham?
Well, Speaker, we've been listening very, very carefully, and I wish the member opposite would also listen carefully to the voices who are supporting, including the—
I'm going to end this quickly. I want to hear the answers.
Speaker, voices supporting this action include Don McCabe, the president of the Ontario Federation of Agriculture. Speaker, I think we should be listening to the farmers of Ontario. Don McCabe said the Ontario government's commitment to carbon pricing reinforces our fight against climate change. We look forward to working with them. Listen to the farmers. Listen to your constituents. Climate change is costing us today. It will cost us only more in the future.
To my colleagues in this House and to people watching today, I have to say, don't be fooled by the comments we've just heard from the Deputy Premier. This announcement this morning has nothing to do with reducing emissions, but rather the introduction of a new revenue tool to cover off their wasteful spending. That's what it's all about. So back to the Acting Premier. Since you won't rethink this disastrous plan and you're fully prepared to raise prices of everything in this province, I want to remind you of a line from the Premier's throne speech. She promised to use evidence before ideology and choose partnership over partisanship. Evidence shows that cap-and-trade systems are riddled with scandal, corruption, and fraud. All things I would dare say your government knows well about. Billions and billions of dollars have been lost to cap-and-trade fraud across the globe, and it's no surprise you're looking to jump on that train. So, Acting Premier, will you prevent the fraud that comes in hand with cap-and-trade?
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
It's quite true that other jurisdictions have gone before us on this, and we are learning from their experiences, Speaker. We will ensure that this is done right in Ontario. In fact, this is done right in Canada. The costs of climate change are staggering, and for the party opposite to ignore the costs of climate change and focus on the costs of cap and trade is disingenuous at best, Speaker. Oh.
Withdraw, please.
I withdraw. Speaker, the National Roundtable on Economy and Environment estimates the cost of climate change in Canada would go from $5 billion in 2020 to at least $21 billion by 2050. Those are real costs borne by real people. I wish the opposition party would have constructive ideas on how to address this very important global problem, Speaker.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Again, back to the Acting Premier. Acting Premier, you have learned nothing from other jurisdictions. The Green Energy Act is a perfect example of the absolute destruction of our province in terms of manufacturing and our homes and families throughout this province. There is a lot of evidence demonstrating the problems now with your carbon tax on everything. Yet, neither the Premier nor her minister could identify today where the revenue from this tax is going to end up. This is a worry. Again, Deputy Premier, you've proven time and time again we cannot trust you. So, Acting Deputy Premier, or pardon me, Acting Premier, will you admit that this cap and trade is just another general revenue tool to supplement your wasteful spending?
I think it's time for the party opposite to pick a lane on this. Just a few weeks ago, they voted in favor. In fact, the member from Huron-Bruce voted in favor of the motion from our member from Glengarry Prescott, a Russell speaker, that reads, in the opinion of this House, the Ontario Legislative Assembly recognizes that scientists agree that climate change is caused by man-made greenhouse gas emissions and poses a serious threat to Ontario's environment, businesses, communities and economists that scientists and leaders of G8 countries, including Canada, have recognized the need to reduce greenhouse gas emissions with the goal of avoiding more than 2 degrees of warming, and affirm that this House must take necessary action to reduce emissions, transition to low-carbon economy, and combat the effects of climate change. You supported that motion 2 weeks ago. Today, you are standing in the way.
Answer.
Of taking
Thank you. New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Deputy Premier. When is it that Ontarians are going to be able to see the Ed Clark report?
Thank you, Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, as the member knows, we are committed to putting our assets to work to create a better Ontario, Speaker, to build Ontario up.
The member from Prince Edward Hastings.
To give us advice on what action we take. I suspect, Speaker, that the Minister of Finance will be able to discuss in more detail about when we might see the results of that work.
Thank you, supplementary.
Perhaps the Deputy Premier can tell Ontarians why Liberals think that it is a good idea to hold a fire sale of Hydro One and local utility companies.
Deputy Premier.
Minister of Finance.
For Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So, Mr. Speaker, the member opposite, in her own platform, when she was seeking the election, she made reference to the very things that we're talking about right now. She based her assumptions on her projections on the ability for us to maximize the value of our assets, to reinvest and repurpose those very issues so that we can afford the things that matter to Ontarians, like transit, like infrastructure, and ensure that we actually gain even greater value from those assets. That is what Mr. Clark and the advisory team are doing and looking at those opportunities, and we will release those in the coming days, in the coming weeks. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Selling Hydro One is going to mean higher hydro bills for families and businesses.
Right.
It's going to mean an end to ombudsman oversight. It's going to mean not being able to shed the light on skyrocketing salaries at the hydro system, like we do right now through the Sunshine List, Speaker. And the Liberals are doing all of this despite decades of Liberals promising that they would never sell off Hydro One. Now, they know that this is a strategic asset for Ontarians, which supports health care and which supports education year over year over year. They know it's an asset that helps us drive conservation, productivity, and efficiency. It is too valuable to put on the auction block, Speaker. Will the Liberals simply rubber stamp
Question.
The sell-off of Hydro One, something that people own?
Minister?
Mr. Speaker, what's important and what's it going to mean is greater efficiencies, more effectiveness of the very assets and Crown corporations that we own so that we can repurpose and maximize its value. It's inappropriate for us not to look at these opportunities, Mr. Speaker. And these are indeed important assets for the province of Ontario and for the people of Ontario, as are the future assets that the people of Ontario are asking us to invest in, Mr. Speaker. And that's what we will do. And I've made it clear before, the Council's work is guided by the following principles. That public interest remains paramount
and protected.
That decisions are aligned with maximizing value to Ontarians, and that the decision process remains transparent, professional, and independently validated, Mr. Speaker. We are looking after the best interest of the public by ensuring we look at
yes,
those
sir.
Opportunities in its entirety. Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Speaker.
Thank you. New question. Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you so much, Speaker. My next question is also for the Deputy Premier. The Liberals ran on a promise not to cut health care, but here we are, and that is exactly what they are doing. So can the Deputy Premier explain why every time there's a Liberal scandal that requires billions of dollars to cover up, the Liberals can find the money, but when it comes to health care and local hospitals, they say that the cupboard, unfortunately, is bare.
Well, Speaker, I must say this question is passing strange coming from that party, given that the member from Kitchener-Waterloo actually said in the campaign that she could find $600 million more. And where would that come from? She said health care and education, Speaker. This is the party that wanted to cut more from our health care, wanted to cut more from our education, Speaker. So I am puzzled by this change of tack, but I can tell you the Minister of Health, I know, wants to speak to some of the investments in health, Speaker, but we'll leave it at that for now.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, last week I visited with families, nurses, doctors, and frontline workers in the Niagara region. They are worried that the Liberal plan to close hospitals is going to put the health of themselves and their loved ones at real risk. There are reports by international experts showing that the Liberal plan lacks, and I quote from that expert, lacks any rational justification. Local Ontario Nurses Association President Loretta Trembassi-Olinsky told me that she felt betrayed by the Liberals, saying, quote, they lied to us. They told us they were going to give us some home care and give us some real relief, end quote.
We can't use quotes even in a way in which it would be unparliamentary, so I want to ask you to withdraw, please.
Can't do a point of order, of course.
Speaker, I withdraw. Quote said they blanked to us. They told us they were going to give us some home care and give us some relief, end quote. My question is simply, when will the Liberals start?
No. I went through this once before. We just do not make that reference whatsoever, even indirectly. So I would ask you to again withdraw. Please.
The Local Nurses Association was very disappointed with the rollout of the Liberals' lack of fulfillment of commitments that they had made previously, Speaker. So my question is, when will the Liberals start keeping their promises and stop cutting the health care system?
Thank you.
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'm happy to talk about our investments in the Niagara Health System, which we're very proud of. Mr. Speaker, the funding in Niagara Region for health care has gone up by 80% since we came into power in 2003. That's an increase of $164 million. But when, to me, Mr. Speaker, what's really important is to look at the progress that we've made and the outcomes that we're seeing, the improved outcomes. So hip replacements, Mr. Speaker, the wait times for hip replacements are down by 48%, Mr. Speaker. That's a massive improvement. Knee replacement wait times are down by 144 days, an improvement of 41%. CT wait times in the Niagara Health System, wait times are down by 78 days, or 81%, Mr. Speaker. So we're seeing incredible progress as our investments, including our investments specifically in decreasing those wait times, are beginning to pay off.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, last week I also visited with moms in Leamington. And the Liberals are cutting health care there too, Speaker. They're firing nurses in Leamington. And Liberal cuts are threatening the closure of Leamington's obstetrics unit, meaning that moms will have to travel an hour or more in order to have their babies in Windsor. Now, I think that Leamington parents should be able to have Leamington babies, Speaker. Will the Liberals actually do the right thing and stop firing nurses, cutting care, and slashing hospitals? That's the question, Speaker. Will they actually do what they said they were going to do and invest in health care, make sure they weren't cutting health care, bring home care services online the way they're supposed to, and save the obstetric wards
question.
In Leamington?
Thank you. Minister?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'm glad that the leader of the third party is finally addressed the issue of Leamington. It's a file, it's an issue, a very important issue that I've been working on diligently for quite a number of months, frankly. And Mr. Speaker, I'm proud of the work that that hospital in the Lynn, under my direction, is doing. When I first learned that of the precarious state of the Leamington Obstetrics Ward, I asked the Lynn to get involved directly with the hospital. They put a pause on things so we could actually have a full community and expert consultation to find out if there were options that would be viable for that hospital that would meet with the confidence of the community. And I met with a delegation of women, midwives and others, mothers who were expecting that had come to Queen's Park a month or so ago, and spoke with them about the real challenges that they're facing, but also the options that they're bringing forward. And I actually believe the process that we put in place with an expert panel, massive community consultation, quite frankly, looking at all innovative options, may actually provide us with it.
Thank you. New question? The member from Renfrew.
My question is for the Deputy Premier. Deputy Premier, when it happened, the Premier won't cancel her trip to Quebec, which I might add would cost taxpayers even more with your new tax on everything. When British Columbia implemented their carbon tax, they pledged to lower other taxes an equal amount so the average family wouldn't be paying more. No more taxes, just different taxes. Deputy Premier, in Economics 101, that's called a tax shift. What your government is doing, that's called a tax grab. You're taking more from the average Ontarian's pocketbook because you can't and won't control your spending. I oppose your cap and tax scheme, but since we can't stop your misguided decision, will you ensure that this will not cost Ontario taxpayers more?
Question,
you will not
Minister of Energy, from the order.
Your newest revenue tool.
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Well, thank you. I think that the member opposite has raised an important question, and that is where will the money raised go? And I can tell you that we will be very transparent in how we spend that money. It will be reinvested back into projects that...
Start the clock. Finish, please.
Speaker, as I was saying,
the member from Simcoe North will come to order second time, right after I got quiet.
Money will be invested transparently back into projects that help reduce pollution and help businesses remain competitive. Projects may include helping families to be more
Member from Bruce Gray, Owen Sound, come to order.
Public transit to reduce congestion, helping plants and businesses reduce their pollution, Speaker. We will be announcing the full plan later this year, but make no mistake, there are savings associated for individual people. In fact, let's look at California. Let's look at the experience in California.
Sir?
I'll save that for the supplementary.
Thank you. Supplement.
Only a Liberal could say that with a straight face, Speaker.
I can't wait for her supplemental.
Again to the Deputy Premier. When a cap-and-trade scheme was introduced in Europe, powerful industrial lobbyists armed with millions of dollars convinced governments to issue more carbon credits than were actually required, than there were actual emissions. And that led to emissions going up, not down. We've all seen what your government does when lobbyists come knocking and you need money or votes. We've witnessed your party cost the taxpayers billions with the gas plant scandal, the e-health scandal, the smart meter fiasco. And you handed out sweetheart deals to your Liberal friends through the Green Energy Act. I doubt this is going to be any different. This scheme sounds like another Liberal boondoggle in the making. Deputy Premier, what do you plan
Minister
to do
of Economic Development.
When the lobbyists come calling?
Speaker, I think it's important to look at the experience of other jurisdictions that have implemented cap and trade. California, for example. And it's true that University of California, Berkeley, estimated that cap and trade does add about 2.6 cents per liter. However, and this is the important however, that seems to be beyond the ability of the...
The member from Bruce Gray, Owen Sound, is warned. Carry on.
Thank you. However, California estimates that the amount the average person spends on fuels declines from $1,400 a year to $1,000 a year because this kind of initiative actually results in improved vehicle efficiency and other measures to reduce fuel use. So, Speaker, there is a cost to climate change. I would love to hear what the party opposite is advising us to do on climate change, or are they just wanting to turn the back on the issue and leap?
The member from Renfrew-Nipissing-Pembroke, come to order. New question. The member from Timmins, James Bay.
My question is to the Deputy Premier. Deputy Premier, can you tell us if the Premier or Deputy Chief of Staff, Madam Sabera, along with Liberal insider Gary Lougheed and the member from Sudbury, if they've had an opportunity to talk
Order.
To the OPP yet in regards to their involvement in the Sudbury bribery scandal?
Speaker, the member opposite knows well that there is an investigation underway, that all members are cooperating fully with that investigation, and that investigation is happening outside the House.
Thank you. Supplementary.
to the Deputy Premier that the Premier has said she was going to meet with the OPP the month of April.
Yeah.
We're now more than halfway through the month. Mm-hmm. I asked you a very simple question. Has the Premier, has Madam Sabera, has Mr. Lougheed, and has the member from Sudbury met with the OPP in regards to that investment?
Order. If the member needs time, he has 10 seconds to wrap.
Sorry, I couldn't see you, Speaker. So my question is, can you tell me when the Gang of Four is going to get those interviews? Will it happen this month?
Thank you.
Speaker, I know the member opposite has a remarkable interest in the timing of the interviews. What I can tell you, Speaker, as you have heard from the Premier, that we are cooperating fully with the investigation that is happening, and it is happening outside the legislature.
Thank you. No question. The member from Barrie.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. In 2014, an estimated 73,800 Ontarians were diagnosed with cancer, and 28,000 of those people died from the disease. This means that 8 people are being diagnosed and 3 people are dying from this disease every hour of the day. I'm happy to say that I'm a 15-year survivor. I hear from my constituents. I hear from my constituents in Barrie that are affected by cancer, either themselves or their families. My heart goes out to all of those affected by the disease. Every day, we are one step closer to finding a cure. The Canadian Cancer Society is a national, community-based organization of volunteers whose mission is the eradication of cancer and the enhancement of the quality of life. Minister, I ask, what are we doing to raise awareness of the Canadian Cancer Society?
Thank you. Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the member from Barrie as well for asking this very important question. We're in Daffodil Month, Mr. Speaker. It's held every April, and it's the national fundraising campaign of the Canadian Cancer Society. And donations that are made during this month, the month of Daffodil Month, help cancer patients and their families and communities right across Ontario by funding life-saving research, support services, and other important work so that fewer Canadians hopefully will be touched by cancer, Mr. Speaker. And thanks to Ontarians' generous support of Daffodil Month and the Canadian Cancer Society's other fundraising programs, the charity was actually able to fund more than $20 million in world-class research to fight all cancers in last year. And during this time, the Society also provided critical support to more than 49,000 Ontarians. So, Mr. Speaker, let's all do our part to support this important month, and I thank the Canadian Cancer Society for their dedication to the cause.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, Ontario is a leader in cancer care in Canada and around the world. I have heard positive feedback from the constituency in my riding about the cancer care system in Ontario, and I thank our government for the wonderful cancer care centre that we have built in Barrie. In fact, in Ontario, an Ontarian who gets cancer has one of the best chances of survival anywhere in the world. But we know that too many Ontarians are diagnosed with cancer each year, which is why we continue to take action to fight this deadly disease. Minister, could you please tell us, I ask, what is our government doing to ensure our cancer screening process is robust?
Question. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you again for the question, Mr. Speaker. Cancer screening is easy, and it definitely saves lives. It's imperative that Ontarians get screened for cancer, and we've worked hard as a government to expand screening services and its availability across this province. We broadened the scope of the Ontario Breast Screening Program back in 2011, so high-risk women are screened earlier, starting at 30 years of age. And this means 90,000 more screens over a three-year period. In 2013-2014, the Ontario Breast Screening Program provided over 500,000 breast screens for average and high-risk women across the province. And there are currently over 150 of these sites, of these Ontario Breast Screening Program sites across the province. We also launched Canada's first province-wide colorectal cancer screening program to combat the second deadliest form of cancer in the country.
And
in 2009, we further expanded cancer detection by funding the PSA test to help fight the most common cancer among Canadians.
Thank you.
There's always more work to be done.
Thank you. New question. The member from Nipissing.
Good morning, Speaker. My question is for the Deputy Premier. We all agree that action must be taken on climate change, but it's your track record It's your track record that leaves something to be desired. When you launched the Green Energy Act, then Minister George Smitherman said, quote, it could lead to a modest increase in electricity bills of about 1%. Since then, the Auditor General told us that tens of billions of dollars later, our hydro rates have tripled to amongst the highest in North America. People are forced now to choose between paying rent or keeping their lights on, between food or fuel. Now you've found a new way to put your hand even deeper into people's pockets. How are you going to make sure that life doesn't become even more unaffordable for Ontarians?
Thank you.
Well, Speaker, I am delighted to know that the member opposite actually believes that action must be taken. The next question is, of course, what action are they proposing? The member from Huron-Bruce this morning offered her advice, and that was to address the issue of
Lanark
in the GTA. We couldn't agree more, Speaker. We want to see, though, we want to see the plan from the Progressive Conservative Party. The easy part of being in opposition is you get to oppose. The harder part of being in opposition, and it's a big responsibility, is to propose better ideas. Speaker, we have yet to hear a better idea coming from the people opposite.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Well, Deputy, we're here to talk about your plan today, so why don't we just call it what it is? It's nothing more than the latest cash grab to pay down your growing deficit. You're going to sell carbon credits in a costly and complex cap-and-trade tax scheme. There will be industry winners and losers. Just like in the Green Energy Act, your Liberal friends are poised to benefit. It's you who will determine which industry is regulated, which sectors are given exemptions. This is your next scandal in waiting. All designed to bring in billions of dollars to satisfy your spending addiction and fool everyone into believing you're actually doing something about climate change. The real concern is how are you going to make sure the latest scheme won't cost us more jobs and more investment in Ontario?
Well, Speaker, I know if the Minister of the Environment and Climate Change were here, he would want to say that we are creating enormous opportunities for people in Ontario, Speaker. We are creating opportunities for farmers, for people in the forestry industry, for those people involved in the technology that will help companies bring down their emissions, Speaker. The member opposite cannot put his head in the sand and say, this isn't costing people today. It is costing people today. It's costing them in their insurance. It's costing government, Speaker, when climate change creates havoc and devastation in our communities. The National Roundtable on the Economy and Environment already pegs the cost of climate change by 2020 will be $5 billion, growing to at least $21 billion by 2050. We are paying the price, Speaker.
Thank
the
you.
Time for action is now.
Thank you. New question. The member from Nickelback.
My question is for the Minister of Health and Long-Term
Care.
The
government is cutting nursing hours and laying off nurses across our province. The minister tries to deflect the blames to hospital, but we all know who funds those hospitals. They say that the nurses' positions are not being eliminated. It is an ebb and flow affair. Speaker, the Minister of Health is the steward of our health care system, so I hope he can tell us, altogether, throughout the hospital system of Ontario, how many nurses and nursing hours have flown out of our hospital system so far, and how many more does he expect?
Thank you. Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And what I can do is refer the member opposite to some of her colleagues who no doubt already have this information about active and open postings for nurses for hospitals in their ridings. For example, the leader of the third party in Hamilton probably knows that there are open active postings to hire 7 RNs and 3 RPNs at the Hamilton Health Sciences Centre. Or in London West at the London Health Sciences Centre, there are active postings to hire 11 RNs and 2 RPMs. or at Kitchener-Waterloo as well. The Grand River Hospital active postings to hire 10 RNs and 2 RPNs. Or at Windsor Regional Hospital, the member for Windsor West would know that there are postings, active postings for 2 RNs and 1 RPN. These are new hirings, Mr. Speaker. These are nurses, new nurses that are going to come into the system. And there is that ebb and flow as programs are created and programs are shifted and nurses are shifted around the hospital.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. I think everybody in this House knows that the first part in addressing a problem is admitting that you have one. So far, I have counted the equivalent of 242 nurses that have already been laid off and close to 500,000 hours of care that have been lost in Ontario Hospital.
Minister of Education, come to
order. A massive decrease in nursing care across our hospital. If a change of this magnitude is not worth the minister's time, then what is? What is? The government likes to say that the nurses are the backbones of our health care system, but it doesn't keep them from cutting nurses and nursing hours across our hospital. My question is quite simple, Speaker. How many more nursing positions need to be eliminated before the minister pays attention?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, you know, I expected better of the member opposite. Yeah. She's a healthcare professional. She knows how the system works. She knows that we have 24,000 more nurses in this province since roughly a decade ago. She knows that there are 10% more in RPNs that are practicing in this province across the hospital since 2009. And, Mr. Speaker, it is correct at Ottawa General Hospital, for example, where they have made some reductions, there will be 5 fewer full-time equivalents in nurses out of that complement of 11,000 staff that practice through that hospital. 11,000. But she may not know, because she's not counting this side of the story, that there are 46 active postings on the website she could go to it of the Ottawa General Hospital for RNs to be hired into that system. So I would ask the member opposite that she be genuine, as I am attempting to be, on this important issue.
Answer.
Yep.
Good question. The member from Durham.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs. Minister, in October 2013, the Premier challenged Ontario's agri-food industry to double its growth rate and create 120,000 new jobs by 2020. The Premier's challenge is an opportunity to show our province, the world, the important contribution our agri-food sector makes to our economy and our quality of life. As we know, expanding trade we can be a key part in developing and strengthening our Ontario's industry at home and abroad. Building relationships with foreign governments and businesses help Ontario showcase and increase our exports and provide new opportunities for Ontarians like those in Durham. China is a key partner in this growth and rapidly changing agricultural sector in Ontario. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please inform this House on his upcoming trade mission to China and how opportunities for agriculture?
Thank you. Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs.
Excellent question.
Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the member from Durham for his question this morning. And I know that he's a champion for agriculture in Durham region, and I know he works very closely. He works very closely with Nancy Rutherford, who is the Economic Development Officer for Agriculture Durham Reed, and she does an outstanding job. Mr. Speaker, Minister Chan and I will be leaving this Wednesday for China, a unique opportunity over the next 10 days to really showcase what Ontario has to offer. We all know this House, at all sides of the House, that Ontario has an outstanding reputation in terms of food safety and food quality. This is a real good opportunity for us, Minister Chan and I, to meet with Chinese agricultural leaders in 4 cities in China and their government leaders to make sure that the Ontario case is presented in China. And more importantly, too, Mr. Speaker, on our last step in Hong Kong, Minister Chan and I will be laying grease at the Commonwealth War Cemetery.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for his excellent answer. Promoting increased trade and investment in Ontario's agriculture food sector will help meet the Premier's growth challenge while keeping Ontario's agri-food sector a world-class leader. But, Minister, if Ontario's industry is positioned to grow and continue to compete internationally, more needs to be done by both government and industry. In order to help meet this challenge, it is essential that government work with industry to promote our agri-food sector while identifying further opportunities for growth and innovation. Right. Mr. Speaker, through you, can the minister please update this House on additional steps our government is taking to support growth in the province's agri-food sector?
Thank you. Minister.
Excellent question. Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the member for a supplementary question. You know, there's a great innovator in agriculture right in his riding of Durham, Algoma Orchards, and I know many people from all sides of the House had the opportunity to visit that operation, which is truly unique, not only provincially, nationally, internationally. We have established, Mr. Speaker, the Growth Steering Committee. It's being co-chaired by Amy Cronin, the very distinguished chair of Ontario Pork, and by very distinguished Deputy Minister, Dr. Deb Stark, who has an outstanding reputation in Ontario's public service. They are coming together with the Growth Steering Committee to work on the Premier's challenge, Mr. Speaker. Premier Wynne gave this sector a challenge, 120,000 new jobs by 2020. And, Mr. Speaker, I assure you, we're going to reach that goal.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Kitchener-Conestoga.
My question is to the acting Premier. Premier Wynne promised the people of Ontario she wouldn't bring any kind of carbon tax in. Yet after a decade-long spending spree, driving the province deep into debt, that's exactly what you're doing. A cap and tax scheme that will damage our economy, put Ontario companies at a competitive disadvantage,
again,
kill jobs, and saddle Ontario families with higher prices. This is a carbon scheme she told Ontarians was, quote, not part of our plan. She lied straight to the face of every Ontarian.
Hear, hear.
The member will withdraw.
Draw.
She did.
So, Deputy Premier, I have a simple question. Do you think the people of Ontario are ignorant, or do you simply have no respect for them?
Thank you.
Wow. Speaker, first of all, I want to ask the member opposite to look back and see that we have, for many years, said that we are going to be introducing a price on carbon, Speaker. This morning we announced that we will be moving forward with the cap and trade process. We have enormous respect for the people of this province. We have enormous respect for the children, Speaker, for our seniors, all of the people who are paying the cost now in their health and in their wallet with climate change, Speaker, with pollution and climate change. We are moving forward, and there is real support for this initiative. The member opposite is part of a party that supported action on climate change, Speaker, just a couple of weeks ago. I think you were right then, and I think you're wrong today. We are moving forward on this, Speaker, because it's the right thing to do today and for future generations.
Yeah, Deputy Premier, climate change is a serious issue that needs to be addressed, but not with a carbon scheme that will hurt our economy, kill jobs, and punish Ontarians with higher taxes and prices. But here's another serious issue: your Liberal government's lack of integrity. The fact is, the Premier told the people of Ontario that a carbon tax was, quote, not in your plans.
Yep.
The last time I asked in this House, I was told a carbon scheme simply does not exist, that I must be reading Alice in Wonderland.
Yep.
Now that you're broke, you've gone down the rabbit hole, you're turning your back on your word and turning toward a $2 billion tax and cap scheme. Deputy Premier, be honest with Ontarians this time and admit what we all know. This scheme isn't about the environment, it's about the money.
Question. Thank you.
Well, Speaker, there are many who would disagree with that statement, and I think the member opposite would like to know some of the people who are actually supporting this initiative. Gideon Foreman, the Executive Director of Canadian Association for Physicians for the Environment. Doctors are very pleased Ontario is moving forward with carbon pricing. Ontario's visionary leadership in eliminating coal power, along with today's announcement on carbon pricing, stand in stark contrast to the federal government's inaction on this file. Speaker, I think that the member opposite would like to know what Jim Lopez, the president and CEO of Tembec, has to say. We congratulate the Government of Ontario on announcing a carbon pricing system to reduce emissions while growing the local economy and jobs, Speaker. Peter Bogue, the president of the Canadian Fuels Association, says the Canadian Fuels Association and its members support the Ontario government's commitment to implement a comprehensive climate change policy.
Thank you. No question. The member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
My question is to the minister responsible for the Pan Am Games. The Hamilton Soccer Stadium was supposed to be ready last June. 9.5 months later, the stadium is still not ready, and under inspections, there are still hundreds of deficiencies. Hamilton police say they need this stadium ready no later than May 1st to prepare for the games. There's now a risk that the stadium will not be ready for the Pan Am Games. Will the city of Hamilton, its businesses, and the residents be compensated if it isn't ready? Can the minister tell us what the government's plan B is, or is there a double meaning, Speaker, when the song from the Pan Am TV spot says, "Ready or not, here I come"?
Thank you. The Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Pan Am Paratime Games.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I know that the Minister of Economic Development will take the second part of this question, but we're proud of where the Hamilton Stadium is at this point. You know, it's 99% complete.
Hamilton likes it.
The Tiger Cats were undefeated in that stadium, so it has been functioning. And in addition to that, Mr. Speaker, we've seen concerts take place there. But I'll tell you, when I had the opportunity, Mr. Speaker, to go to the stadium, I saw something remarkable taking place. Not only has that development changed that stadium, which was 100 years old, it has changed the area around it. And you're starting to see economic development in that part of town. And I think the member opposite should be out there pushing the success of this stadium to the people in his constituency, because I'll tell you, it's one of the best investments to come into Hamilton for years. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. What I love about this minister, everything's always rosy. Speaker, my second question is to the Minister of Infrastructure. Why will Infrastructure Ontario be handing over the full $89 million to Ontario Sports Solutions before the stadium is complete, which you withheld? Why is there no provision in that contract to reduce, not merely postpone, that $89 million payment for almost 1 year delay? Why is it that the public and the local subcontractors are the only one being penalized for the main contractor's incompetence? How many other P3 arrangements have been toothless to reimburse the public for costly delays caused by the incompetence of the contractor? And what has this cost the public?
Stop the clock. The Deputy House Leader will come to order. And the question has to be directed to the minister. They choose whether or not they move it to the other minister. Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. To the minister responsible for infrastructure.
Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. But the last person we're going to take any advice from on this particular issue when it comes to the contract is the NDP, because if they had their way, we would have done this under traditional financing, which would have meant any cost of delays would have been on the backs of the taxpayers. Because we did this through alternative financing procurement, it will not cost the taxpayers, Mr. Speaker, for any delays. This project is 99% complete.
Finish, please.
The members, Mr. Speaker, some of the facts before they keep heckling. These are some of the things that still need to be done. Waterproofing around the bleachers, IT systems integration, testing of IT and sound equipment, some water damage repairs to drywall. That's part of the 1% left to be completed. We're absolutely confident this will be completed in time for the games.
Because
we didn't do it the NDP's way, any delays will not be on the backs of taxpayers.
Question, the member from Cambridge.
Speaker, thank you very much. My question is for the Associate Minister of Finance. Minister, I know that our government's very concerned about the under-savings problem. Several studies have shown that Ontarians are not saving enough and that without action, many will face a decline in their standards of living in their retirement. I know this is an issue that many of my constituents in Cambridge are particularly concerned about. They want to know that after decades of working and contributing to the economy, that both they and their children will be able to retire with dignity. That's why so many are pleased to see that our government's taking leadership by creating the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan. Speaker, it was brought to my attention that McKinsey & Co. recently released a study that found that many Canadians are on track for saving for their retirement. Speaker, through you, can the minister please explain how our government is reconciling these different findings?
Associate Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the wonderful member from Cambridge for that very important question. Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to clarify those findings for the members of this House. When we look at McKinsey's findings, it's a question of demographics. The study shows that while older generations may fare well in retirement, younger generations face different challenges. The author of the McKinsey study said this: projecting the situation in retirement for someone who is 55 or 60 today can be done with a lot of accuracy or confidence, while someone who is 25 or 30, any study will have a greater factor of uncertainty. As well, Fred Vitas, the chief actuary at Morneau-Chapelle, has said that while he believes that those a decade or so away from retirement may have enough saved, young people are definitely going to have some challenges. Mr. Speaker, this is exactly why our government is taking action to ensure not only us, also our children and grandchildren can save for retirement.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, and thank you to the minister for that response. I'm pleased to know that our government is reviewing a variety of different studies as it continues to consider key design features of the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan. I've also noticed that a variety of new polls released by major Canadian institutions underscore how little that Ontarians are saving. In the last few months, I've seen alarming findings from RBC, CIBC, Sun Life Financial, and just last week, BMO Financial, that all point to a major under-savings problem. These polls highlight that not only how few Ontarians feel prepared for retirement, but also how many Ontarians have not even begun to save. Speaker, can the minister please share some of these recent findings with the members of this House and discuss how our government is addressing this issue?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you again to the member from Cambridge. Earlier this year, I traveled to 10 communities across the province to speak with Ontarians. It was very clear that retirement is top of mind. It's easy to understand why people are concerned about retirement when you read the findings of recent studies. According to a study from BMO released last week, only 43% of Canadians are saving for retirement. An RBC study found that 30% of Canadians have not begun to save for retirement. And Sun Life Financial study found that 60% of respondents now expect to work past 65, up from 48% in 2008. Mr. Speaker, these studies paint an alarming picture. It's hard to understand how our colleagues on the other side of the House can look at these numbers and still suggest that we do nothing to address this issue. Mr. Speaker, our government, on the other hand, is committed to taking leadership, and that's why we're introducing the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Deputy Premier. Thank you.
Ask, please.
Thank you, Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Deputy Premier. Deputy Premier, the European experience with cap and trade has proven to be what not to do for the economies around the world, a sleight of fancy. Energy rates have skyrocketed across Europe. Germany's economics and energy minister stated that his country faces dramatic deindustrialization if energy costs cannot be reduced. However, today your government has announced that Ontario will commit to a cap and tax scheme, therefore committing to an increased burden on business and the people of Ontario with unacceptably high energy costs. Deputy Premier, will this carbon tax raise energy costs in Ontario?
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Thank you, Speaker. I'm very proud of the action that our Premier and our government has taken this morning, that we have joined with the province of Quebec, that we are implementing a very important initiative that will reduce greenhouse gas emissions, Speaker. That is the right thing for us to be doing. Just a few weeks ago, the party opposite thought it was the right thing to do. Today, they have a different opinion. As I said to an earlier member, you were right a couple of weeks ago when you supported the motion from the MPP from Glengarry Prescott Russell. Speaker, I really think it's time for constructive advice to come from the party opposite.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Supplementary again to Deputy Premier, Mr. Speaker. The evidence is overwhelming. Your carbon tax is a cost taxpayers cannot afford. In Germany, steel producers now pay double the U.S. rate for electricity and four times as much for natural gas because of cap and tax. Just imagine how much higher Ontario's rates will rise. Here in Canada, three of the five provinces that are the furthest from their 2020 greenhouse gas reduction targets have carbon taxing schemes already. Clearly, they're not working. Deputy Premier, why are you ignoring the evidence? Does your government not realize that your carbon tax does nothing more than raise the price of all goods? That's right.
Speaker, let me one more time read into the record the motion that the party opposite supported just 2 weeks ago. In the opinion of this House, the Ontario Legislative Assembly recognizes that scientists agree that climate change is caused by man-made greenhouse gas emissions and poses a serious threat to Ontario's environment, businesses, communities and economy, that scientists and leaders of G8 countries, including Canada, have recognized the need to reduce greenhouse gas emissions with the goal of avoiding more than 2 degrees of warming, and affirm that this House must take necessary action to reduce emissions, transition to a low-carbon economy, and combat the effects of climate change. Speaker, this government is acting in response to the will of this House.
Answer. Thank you. New question. The member from Windsor West. Oshawa.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the acting Premier. Speaker, the Premier promised she would not make cuts to education. Yet her government just handed out pink slips to 118 contract teachers at the Kawartha Pine Ridge District School Board. Our schools are already underfunded, but instead of investing in education, the Premier is choosing to gut the system. Speaker, if the Premier isn't making cuts to education, how does she explain taking 118 teachers out of the classroom?
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Well, thank you, Speaker. And the NDP is fortunate in that they have three former school board trustees within their caucus, Speaker. The member from Windsor West was trustee on the Greater Essex County District School Board, and she actually supported motions to close Forrester Secondary School and Victoria Public School. When asked to explain the board's decision, Chair Helga Bailey said, "We have to do this because otherwise we're spending money on bricks, mortar and empty space." Speaker, the member from London West was a trustee. I know her well, at the Thames Valley District School Board. She voted to close Sir Winston Churchill Public School, Colborne Street Public School, Southdale Public School, Maple Lane Public School, Ralph Street Public School, West Elgin Senior Elementary School, Sir George Ross Secondary School. The members opposite know education is complex. These decisions are not easy. I don't know why they continue to criticize government for doing what they actually did.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, I'm pleased to respond to the Deputy Premier and remind her that while we have three former trustees, we also have a former teacher. And I'm pleased to say that I know firsthand just how squeezed our schools already are. I also know that we should be giving our students a leg up, not trying to balance the budget on their backs. Speaker, every teacher that this government cuts directly affects our students' education experience. Will the Premier stay true to her word and stop cutting and gutting our education system?
Minister of Education.
Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you very much, and I'm very pleased to be able to answer this question and actually to remind my critic for the NDP that we haven't decreased the funding this year. In fact, the funding last school year was $22.5 billion. The funding this year is $22.5 billion. doesn't sound like a cut to me. The funding is stable. In fact, we've done some really interesting things this year. We've actually doubled the funding for school renewal projects. That's for that major sort of repair the roof, fix the leaky window, replace the boiler. Last year there was $250 million.
Answer.
This year, Speaker, there's $500 million. So that boards have been telling me for ages that there's a backlog.
Thank you.
We're going to fix that back.
Thank you. New question. The member from Halton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs. Speaker, my riding of Halton is home to a diverse and vibrant First Nations community that has played a vital role in our region's history. In fact, close to 10% of the entire Aboriginal population that lives in and around the GTA reside in Halton. And the Iroquoian village at Crawford Lake continues to be one of the key educational and historical treasures in our community. We all know a strong and vibrant First Nation community strengthens Ontario culturally, socially, and economically. I know our government has demonstrated its commitment to invest in programs and services that cater to First Nations peoples in Ontario. Speaker, through you to the Minister, what is our government doing to create a stronger relationship with the Northern First Nation communities in Ontario?
Minister of Aboriginal Affairs.
Speaker, developing meaningful relationships with First Nations is a priority for this government. In fact, last week I traveled to Timmins, Ontario to participate in the Mushkigawik Council of Chiefs. So that's made up of seven communities in the James Bay area. The purpose of the meeting was to discuss strengthening governance and economic development in First Nations. I met with the Grand Chief to hear about some of the priorities coming out of the region, and I'm eager to continue those discussions. Speaker, Premier Wynne has directed this government to move forward with a new treaty strategy tactic. It will facilitate constructive engagement on treaties, revitalize treaty relationships, and promote improved socioeconomic outcomes for Aboriginal peoples. And as we continue to move forward on these discussions, to highlight an even stronger commitment to develop First Nations, to develop their economic interests as best we can. This is good for First Nations, Speaker. This
Thank
is good
you.
For the people of Ontario.
Thank you. Point of order, member of Kitchener-Waterloo.
Everyone will join me in welcoming Scott Travers, President of the Society of Energy Professionals, who is here with many members today, and I hope that you'll all be at the reception today at 5 p.m. Thank you.
Thank you. The Deputy House Leader on point of order.
Yes, Mr. Speaker, I rise to correct my record. George McCaig was a former member of this legislature from the riding of Dufferin Simcoe from 1975 to 1987, as I recall, and my note said 78, so corrected as 1975.
Thank you. All members are allowed to correct their record. The Minister of Energy and a point of order.
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to seek unanimous consent supporting Ontario's only team led by the Hamburglar in the Stanley Cup playoffs this year.
Go ahead.
The Minister of Energy is seeking unanimous consent to support the Hamburglar. Do we agree? No. Okay, thank you. There are no deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 1 p.m. this afternoon.